Let us now open God's holy word. This morning we will listen to God's word proclaimed from Psalm 147. So let's turn in our Bibles now to Psalm 147. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted, and he binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He covers the heavens with clouds. He prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass grow on the hills. He gives to the beasts their food and to the young ravens that cry. His delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the legs of a man, but the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion. For he strengthens the bars of your gates. He blesses your children within you. He makes peace in your borders. He fills you with the finest of wheat. He sends out his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly. He gives snow like wool. He scatters frost like ashes. He hurls down his crystals of ice like crumbs. Who can stand before his cold? He sends out his word and melts them. He makes his wind blow and the waters flow. He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and rules to Israel. He has not dealt thus with any other nation. They do not know his rules. Praise the Lord. So far, the reading of God's word and also of our text, Psalm 147. Let's respond to this reading and also prepare ourselves for the ministry of the word by singing now together from the same psalm, Psalm 147. At this time, we'll sing stanzas 1, 2, and 3. Let us stand to sing. Beloved brothers and sisters of our Lord Jesus Christ, the book of Psalms ends with five poems or offerings of praise to our God. These five Psalms are called the Hallel Psalms, and they are called that because the first and the last words of these Psalms, these five Psalms, are the word Hallelujah, Hallelujah, and that is a word that simply means praise the Lord, as our translation puts it. And it's between these two words of these last five psalms, the beginning and the last word, it's between these words that we find all the reasons for praising the Lord. These, brothers and sisters, are what you would call the true praise and worship songs. That is to say, these are intelligent songs. You're not going to find the endless repetition of the same words, but you will find here in a true praise and worship song the detailed description of God's actions and God's words. That is to say, you will find the whys and the therefores of our praise. And it's appropriate that the book of Psalms ends on these notes of praise, because this is also typical of what the Psalms are. Even the complaint Psalms or the lament songs, Do this. Their last words are not protest to God. In the end, the psalmist, the singer doesn't complain, but praises God for all of his power and especially for the hope that we have in him. Now the question is, why do we look at this psalm this morning, Psalm 147? Well, in this psalm we will read some special verses in this praise and worship song, special reasons for our praise to God, and I'm referring to the verses 4 and 5, where it says, He determines the number of the stars, He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. These verses are serving as the theme for Dufferin Christian School this year. And this is why we want to look at these verses, but also the whole psalm, giving attention to the reasons why we ought to praise our God and sing with all our heart and mind and soul to Him. I preached you God's Word under this theme, it is good to sing praises to our God. That's how we summarize the message. It is good to sing praises to our God. And we'll see three things. We will praise Him for His power, we will praise Him for His care, and we will praise Him for His Word. So first, we will consider that we praise God for His power, and we can find this in the first stanza of this psalm, the verses 1 through 6. You'll note that there's three stanzas by the fact that we read the words, praise the Lord, at the beginning of those stanzas. So verse 1, verse 7, sing to the Lord with thanksgiving, and then finally verse 12, praise the Lord. Praise your God. So it's good to sing praises to God. The psalmist says it's pleasant, it's fitting. God doesn't need our praise. That's what these words are saying when we say it's good or it's pleasant or it's fitting. He doesn't need our praise, but He certainly deserves it. God deserves the church's praise because of all that He has done for her. Look what it says in verse 2. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. That is to say, because of sin in this world, we are a hurting people. But God has brought about deliverance and restoration and healing. One is not able to determine the specific context of this psalm. That is to say, we don't know exactly when it was written or for what specific reason it may have been written. It could be a post-exilic psalm where the people have returned to Judah after exile and they want to praise God for all His goodness. It could also be a time of great peace in the land, where the people are enjoying security under the kingship of David or even more under his son Solomon. And they want to give thanks for that. What is certain here, brothers and sisters, is that the generic quality of this psalm ensures that it is one for all the ages. And it first speaks then to deliverance and freedom. It speaks to God's goodness. These are reasons for praising the Lord. All of this is evidence of His power in our lives. His power is evident also in creation. That's what we see in the verses 4 to 5. We see that creation is displaying the wisdom of God. It is showing that His understanding is infinite, that all of it is without limit and beyond measure. You know, the Israelites were in many ways just like we are. They also had to go to work every day or walk to school. And when those Israelites did that, They could see the flowers and the green hills and the olive groves. They could observe the snow-peaked mountains. They could hear the bubbling brooks and the buzzing of bees and the lowing of cattle. They could feel the cool breeze or feel the warm sun on their backs. They could look up into the blue sky and see the birds flying and the clouds drifting by. And then walking home from work or relaxing after dinner, they could sit outside and observe the night sky and marvel at the moon and the planets and the millions and billions of stars. Of course, they didn't know there were that many. There are actually only 10,000 stars that are visible to the naked eye. The psalmist makes a special observation here about the stars. God determines the number of the stars. Today we know that there are more than 10,000 of them. There are millions and billions of them. And each one of them, God knows by name. He has given to all of them a name. It's only in the last half century that mankind has begun to actually name some of the stars, give them proper names. So only a few hundred have them today. Traditional astronomy tended to group stars in constellations and give names to the constellations, but not to the individual stars. It's only recent that this has become something of a thing to do. But in our text, we read that God has done this since creation, and He knows each one of them. He is that powerful. And then we also note that in Scripture, God uses that fact to underline the marvel of His recreation, of His salvation of souls. The Israelites were also called on a number of occasions to look into the night sky and see the stars and recall how God had told Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and others to look at those stars also and remember God's covenant promises. The Lord had said that. The stars are so numerable, so shall your descendants be. Yes, even in the face of suffering or persecution or seeing the inheritance from afar, God's people are to remember those promises that He is a God of salvation, that He is a God who saves a people for Himself, that He is a God who knows each one of His children by name. These are reasons to praise God. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcast. He heals the brokenhearted. He binds up their wounds. We, beloved, are also part of that heritage. Yes, we ought to praise God above all because of His redemption through Jesus Christ. God has brought it about that His chosen ones are saved through Christ's death on the cross to pay for their sins. And so at the baptism of His covenant children, God speaks to each of them by their name. So great is His power. He remembers our names. Our Canons of Dort illustrates the power of this recreation, of this regeneration, that He works in the hearts of men to save them. In chapter 3, 4 of the Canons of Dort, in article 12, which is called, the title is Regeneration is the Work of God Alone, we read that regeneration is clearly a supernatural, most powerful, and at the same time most delightful, marvelous, mysterious, and inexpressible work. According to Scripture, inspired by the author of this work, regeneration is not inferior in power to creation or the raising of the dead. I'll repeat those last words. Regeneration is not inferior in power to creation or the raising of the dead. Brothers and sisters, the fact that we believe in God and in Jesus Christ and in the Holy Spirit is no less evidence of God's power than the creation in which we live. His covenant love, His redemption, His salvation is that powerful. And it's on that power we rely for God to work faith in us and in our children and to bless the instruction they receive. All power for which we should praise the Lord. And not only praise Him for His power, but also praise Him for His care. This we see in the second point as we turn to the verses 7 to 11. In this second stanza, we read more reason to give thanks to God. A thanksgiving that is stimulated by God's care for His creation. And it's good to note this at this special time of thanksgiving. We again take note of the depth of a praise and worship song and the intelligent reasons for our praise. The pagan nations that surrounded the people of Israel spoke of the forces of nature, or they attributed creation and the preservation and the order of the universe to a multitude of gods. And then natural disasters would be attributed to them as well, this time to their anger, or perhaps because the gods were fighting against each other. Today, many people will also look around. They'll observe creation. They'll observe its preservation and its government and talk about natural laws and evolutionary processes. And then when disaster strikes, they talk about Mother Nature, who is responsible. Or, lately, they blame mankind. But the psalmist attributes it all to God. Like a quilter creates a patchwork, so God covers the heavens with clouds. Like a gardener waters the garden, so the Lord waters the earth. Like a landscaper tends the ground, so God causes the grass to grow. Like a farmer will feed his cattle, so the Lord gives food to the animals of the earth. Like a child will feed a bird, so God feeds the birds. This psalm reminds us, this psalm confirms our confession that God is the provider of all things. That's how the Belgic Confession puts it in Article 2, stating that the creation, preservation, and government of the universe is teaching us something of God. That He is the only God of heaven and earth. That He is the all-powerful and all-good and caring God. Article 2 puts it this way, that this creation and preservation and government of the universe is before our eyes as a most beautiful book, wherein all creatures, great and small, as so many letters leading us to perceive clearly God's invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, as the Apostle Paul says in Romans 1:20. Our article states there in Belgian Confession, Article 2, that for the wicked who thus deny God, it all leaves them without excuse. But for the believers, it is reason upon reason upon reason, 10,000 reasons to praise the Lord. And thus God, we read in our text, is not impressed with human strength. Verse 10, it says, his delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the legs of a man. And the rhymed version we sang together shows that that's a reference to armies. God is not impressed with our strength. Today, men and boys are especially impressed with the power of their trucks or their physical strength, their big biceps and their muscular legs. They're impressed with powerful armies. But God isn't impressed at all. It's not horsepower that impresses God, but we read in our psalm, it's humility that impresses him. And it isn't muscle that influences the Lord, but it's his mercy that does so. And just like as we saw concerning God's power in creation, we see that also in his care for creation, that this is also true for redemption as well. That today, as believers, as parents, we rely daily on the merciful care of our Heavenly Father who provides for us with all things necessary for body and soul. We also see God's hand in adversity and in tragedy, that at times God doesn't prevent it, but that he allows it so that his promises can come in full effect and he can turn all things to our benefit. Yes, God cares for us, he cares for our souls, and we depend on him, and thus in humility we praise him. Finally, we consider that we praise God for his word. The last stanza, the verses 12 to 20, again begins with a call to praise God. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion, we read. Why? Because God is the protector of the church. He strengthens the bars of your gates, verse 13. Why? Because God is the provider of life. Also, verse 13, he blesses your children with you. It's because God is the maker of harmony, verse 14. He makes peace in your borders. And he is the giver of prosperity, also verse 14. He fills you with the finest of the wheat. All of it is possible because of God's word, which is again evident in creation. With words, God created this world, and with words, he cares for it and provides for it. So with a word, God blankets the earth, the ground with snow. He paints the landscape with frost. He throws down hail from heaven like a child throws a handful of stones. He breathes out cold and freezes everything in its path. He blows again, and this time everything melts and the waters flow. Oh, what a God we have! What a word he speaks! And then, like the other stanzas, he turns to redemption. He speaks of God's word and redemption. And as such, it brings us to the climax of this psalm, verses 19 and 20. He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and rules to Israel. He has not dealt thus with any other nation. They do not know his rules. Israel, God's people, received his revelation, his laws, his word. All people have received God's general revelation, that is his creation and providence and the government of the universe, prosperity and health, etc. But only Israel, only the covenant people, only the church has received God's special revelation, his revealed will and written word. Beloved, to be able to have and hold and to read God's special revelation, his word, the Bible, is the most beautiful thing of God. And for this, he is to be most worthy to be praised. It's the best reason of all that we can sing to him. He has given to us his word, the revelation of himself, which most clearly and certainly teaches us about his one and only Son, Jesus Christ. And this makes the theme for DCS most fitting. The God who knows every star is the God who knows and loves each and every one of his covenant children. He gives to each of them his word. And thus we're so thankful that we can provide a Christian education based on and in line with that word in all of the subject areas. Praise the Lord. Yes, beloved, let us in all things respond with true praise and worship to our God. His revelation, in fact, engages our mind and our will and our emotions, our whole person. In that word, we see that God has entered into relationship with us. He creates in us responsibility to reply to him, not only with tongues loosened for praise, but with lives freed for thanksgiving service. He has given us his laws so that we might obey them in true thanksgiving and walk along paths of peace. Yes, our true worship should be accompanied by whole life obedience. Our God calls us to praise him, also in the hearing of the lost, so that they too may hear the word of God, the word of Christ, and believing to live. Praise God for his power. Praise God for his care. Praise God for his word. As we see in conclusion, Psalm 147 is truly a praise and worship song that's highlighted by the way it begins and by the way it ends with the word hallelujah, praise the Lord. God determines the number of the stars and gives to all of them their names. He knows his covenant children especially, their names, and provides them with wonderful promises. Above all, we praise him for his power and care and word in redemption, that we may know and confess the Lord Jesus Christ truly is praise to God, and it fills us with praise. Amen. Let us